Welcome to Math Explore Infinity. I am absolutely thrilled to have you embark on this extraordinary journey into the captivating world of functional analysis. Whether you are a seasoned mathematician in search of deeper insight or someone stepping into the wondrous realm of mathematics, this series is your guide through the core concept, theories, and application of functional analysis, a foundation more akin to bedrock than a mere branch of mathematics. I mean, just imagine functional analysis as the intricate framework supporting the grand architecture of mathematical exploration. I mean, this series particularly holds a special place in my heart because I firmly believe that understanding functional analysis is not just beneficial, but it is essential for those striving to conquer the frontiers of advanced mathematics. So as we set sail on this journey, rest assured that even though we are diving straight into the majestic Hahn-Banach theorems in our first lecture, I'm fully committed to serving you the most intricate proofs with the ease of morning sunlight where elegance meets accessibility. So join me as we venture forth into this exhilarating expedition, peeling back layers of mystery surrounding functional analysis and unveiling the extraordinary beauty nestled within the realm of functions and spaces. I know. I mean, of course, I know the introduction was a bit of a mouthful, but don't worry. We are now shifting gears, right? So to kick things off, in this initial section, we will dive into the analytic form of the Hahn-Banach theorems, right? As you see on my screen, which is basically just, the gateway to extending linear functionals and enriching our mathematical toolkit somehow. So in this section, let's start with some definition. So in this section, E stands for a vector space over R. So let me just write it quickly. So let E be a vector space over R. And then we start with some definition, right? So a map P defined from the space E to R, it's called sublinear. If and only if the following property holds. Number one, let's change the color. For every lambda strictly greater than zero, and for every x in E, P of lambda x is equal to lambda P of x. And the second property is that, if I have two elements in E, this looks a bit like the triangle inequality, right, if you want. P of x plus y should be less or equal than P of x plus P of y. So if you have a map that actually fulfills these two properties, then we call such a map a sublinear map. So let's have some examples, right? So first example, it's kind of obvious. Every semi-norm or norm, if you want, every semi-norm is sublinear. Second example, every linear map, of course, is actually sublinear. And then finally, our third example would be, I will introduce a new notion. I mean, some of you might be familiar with that notion, or some of you might not. So, so the Minkowski functional of a set C. Defined as of another color, P of X to be the inf, right? Alpha greater than zero, such that X over alpha belong to C, right? This is sublinear. Provided that for every C convex, right, with zero belonging to the interior of C. So let's prove this last example very quickly. Let's prove that the Minkowski functional of a convex set containing zero, I mean, for which zero is an interior point, is actually a sublinear map. So, proof of C. So, the first thing to do, I mean, as a good mathematician, is actually to show that P is well defined. That is, we don't have any blow up, right? P of X is finite for every X and E. So, indeed, that was our claim. Indeed, put for every X and E, AX, right? Define AX to be set of alpha positive, right, such that X over alpha, X over alpha belong to C. So, I mean, we aim at showing that AX is not empty, right, for every X and E. Of course, the case X equals zero is trivial, right? Because you have the assumption that zero is an interior point, right? And then we know that the interior of C is actually contained into C. So we basically have, I mean, we don't have anything to prove here actually. So this means that one is basically in A0. So we are mainly concerned with the case X different from 0. So let X belong to E, right? But different from 0. Since 0 belongs to the interior of C, right? You can always find, I mean, an arbor around 0 that is contained into C, such that the ball centered at zero and radius R is actually contained into C. So then from this we see that norm of X over R minus 1, right, times X belong to C. So this means norm of X, right, by definition of the Minkowski functional, it means that this belongs to AX. Then we can conclude that AX is actually different from 0 for every X in E. And 0 strictly less than px, which is. So, it is well defined. Now you can start proving, I mean, properties of the sublinearity. So, first one, right, let lambda positive, right? We have, we aim at showing that p of lambda x is equal to lambda p of x, but I'm going kind of straightforward. So p of lambda x, right, is by definition the inf of alpha positive, right, such that lambda x over alpha belong to C. But this is nothing else again as the inf of what of, can write it as lambda times alpha over lambda, right? Strictly positive, so is that x over alpha over lambda, right? Belong to C. And then I can pull out the lambda without any problem, because those are positive numbers, so. And then this is again, I mean, lambda times the inf C of the beta positive, such that x over beta. You want to see. And then this is by definition, I mean, P of x. So the first property is proof, right? So for the second one, so let xy belong to E, right? So we want to show that, let me write it fully. We want to show that P of x plus y is less or equal than P of x plus P of y. Style it a bit. Nice. So again here we consider, right, just again we consider for every x in E, I mean Ax, right, so that the alpha positive such that x over alpha belong to C. So I claim, I mean, not it is enough. It is enough to show that. It's enough to show that AX plus AY is actually contained into AX plus Y. So as it will imply, I mean, due to the fact that put A dot, right, it's a subset of R plus. So it will imply that that the inf of A x plus y is less or equal than the inf of ax plus the inf of ay, right? And then we observe that this is not changed than p of x plus y, then this will be p of x, and then this is p of y. So this is actually the main idea behind. So let alpha x, alpha y, right, belong to ax, ay respectively, right? So that means x over alpha x, right, belong to C, and x over alpha y belong to C. So by convexity of C, it follows that alpha x over alpha x plus alpha y of x over alpha x plus alpha y over alpha x plus alpha y x over alpha y belong to C. Well, why is this? Observe that this quantity here, let me duplicate it. Observe that this quantity, they both lie in 0, 1, right? And sum up to 1. And sum up to 1. So, this means that x plus y alpha x plus alpha y belong to C, right? And this is nothing else than saying that alpha x plus alpha y belong to ax plus y. Hence, p of x plus y is less or equal than p of x plus p of y. And then we are done. Good. Now let's take a first remark, right? Let's take a first remark. First thing, if C is actually open, convex, and zero is an interior point, zero belongs to C, then if C is a subset of E, is, we put it in color, it's open, convex, and 0 belongs to C, right? Then, number 1, I can find a constant M positive, right? Such that 0 is less or equal than P of X. So you got an m times the norm of x, and this for every x in E. Number 2, we can characterize all element of C by element of E, such that the Minkowski functional of C is strictly less than 1. Good. So let's have a quick proof of this remark. Right. Let me write it here. Proof. So we start with the first point. Right. So we want to show that there is a constant M positive such that this holds actually. Okay, so since 0 belongs to C, right, and C is open, this point is rather straightforward, I would say, and C is open, there is this positive, right, by definition of openness, so it's just the ball centered at 0 and radius r is contained into C, and then as above, this means norm of x over r minus 1 times x belong to C, and this of course holds for every x in E and x different from 0. So we clearly have of x less or equal than 1 over r times the norm of x for every x belong to e. So so this is can set this to be equal to m if you want. So the second point is also quite easy, right? But not that obvious. So we want to show that style it. You want to show that C, I mean, element of C are element of E, such that the Minkowski functional at the point X of C is actually strictly less than 1. Of course, I mean, if you want to show that two sets are equal, I mean, the first thing you have to think about is actually the double inclusion. So, so let x in C, right? Since C is open, there exists a claim that I can always find an epsilon positive, right? Small enough. Such that 1 plus epsilon x belong to C. So this means by definition of the Minkowski functional, right, as being the inf, so this means p of x is less or equal than 1 over 1 plus epsilon, right, which is strictly less than 1, definitely. So we have definitely proven that C is actually contained into the set of X and E, such that P of X is strictly less than 1. So conversely, let X and E, right, such that P of X, write it like this, with P of X strictly less than 1. Then, I mean, you have the inf of a set strictly less than 1, I mean, then, by definition, right, then by definition of the Minkowski function at the point X, right, I mean, there is this alpha, right, between 0 and 1, right, such that alpha minus 1, let me write it properly, times x belong to C. However, right, you have the assumption that 0 is an interior point, I mean 0 belongs to C, and C is convex. So this means that alpha times alpha minus 1 of x plus, I mean property of convexity, this belongs to C, right? So this means x belongs to C, and then this proves that, I mean, the set of x in E such that P of x is strictly less than 1 is actually containing to C, whence the equality. Okay, this result will be useful, I mean, in the upcoming section. Okay. So I think we are now kind of ready to state our first theorem for this first section, theorem 1.1. And this is, well, this is the Hahn-Banach analytic form. Really, Hahn-Banach analytic form. So, what does the theorem say? So, if we write it here, if D is a subset of E, right, it's a linear subspace. Of the R vector space E. P defined from E to R is sublinear functional. Let me write it here. So, sublinear functional and D defined from capital D to R is a linear functional. It's a linear functional such that such that D of X is less or equal than P of X for every X in V, then there exists a linear functional, right, that extends G, and such that F of X is actually less or equal than P of X. There exists a linear functional F, right, defined on the whole space. Such that F extend G, that means F restricted to the domain of G is equal to G, right? And F of X is also equal than P of X for every X in E. Good. So the proof of the Hahn-Banach theorem, I mean the analytic form, basically relies on something that I'm going to recall the Zahn's lemma. Recall. Let me write it in color. Zahn's lemma. So the Zahn's lemma actually states that every non-empty ordered set that is inductive, right? Inductive means that every chain has an upper bound. So if I have a non-empty inductive, a non-empty ordered set that is inductive, then it has a maximal element. So let me write it. Every non-empty ordered set that is inductive, right? Inductive. We put it in bracket. What it means? That is every chain has a bound. Has an upper bound, I mean. Every non-empty ordered set that is inductive has a maximal element. So that was for the recall, and now I think we can start the proof, right? Which is a bit, I mean, not really constructive, right? So consider, I mean, the set. Consider the set, let's call it capital P, right? Defined to be, those are the function h, right? Defined from dh, by dh I mean the domain of h to r, right? Such that, good. Such that first thing, domain of H is a linear subspace. It's a linear subspace of E. Number two, H is linear, and G is actually a subset of domain of H, and then the third property is that H extends G, H restricted to G equal to G, and H of X is less or equal than P of X for every X belonging to the domain of H. Drag this part bit here. Good. Now we can close the bracket like this. Okay. We endow this set P with the following order relation. So we endow P with the following. The relation. Maybe say that, I mean, H1 is in relation with H2, right? If and only if the domain of H1 is contained into the domain of H2, and H2 extend H1, that is H2 restricted to the domain of H1 is nothing else than H1. Okay, so well, let me just write it. It is clear that P is non-empty, right? That our set is non-empty as G belongs to P, right? Because G is given, right, in the theorem, so P is well defined. So our first claim is that P is inductive. So claim one, then we will prove it also. P is inductive. Indeed. Let Q, right? Call it Q. Be a chain. Well, I've been talking about chain, but a chain is nothing else, is nothing else as a totally ordered subset of the set V. So that is totally ordered. Subset. So we can write Q as being the set of the sequence of function h i belonging to capital I. So, and we set I mean, we want to show that this chain actually has an upper bound. And then for that, we set GH, right, to be the union of GHI, so the domain, and H of X, we define H of X to be equal HI of X, right, if X belongs to the domain of HI for some I. Put it in, doesn't look nice. Good. So by definition of H, right, H obviously belongs to, I mean, this is by definition, I mean, this, there is nothing here to prove. By definition, H is obviously an element of P, right, and H is clearly and upper bound. For Q. Since P is actually not empty, I mean, since P is not empty. Non empty, non empty other set that is inductive according to Zohn's lemma. P has a maximal element. That a maximal element that we call F belonging to P. Good. Now, to conclude the proof, we make another claim, right? This will be our finite claim. Claim number two. The domain of F is nothing else than E. Right? I mean, to prove this, I mean, we proceed by contradiction. So, I mean to a contradiction. Assume that they are different, right? So this means there exists, right? X0, right? Belonging to E. Such that x0 does not belong to the domain of F. I mean, just note that this x0 is actually is different from 0, right? Because, I mean, domain of F is actually a linear subspace of E, so it basically contains the 0 of E, so the x0 is actually different from 0. So, now, put domain of H, right, to be what, to be equal to the domain of F plus, I mean, plus the span. I mean, by this I mean the span, of x0, and then define H to be from domain of H to R, right? Element of domain of H is R written as X plus TX0, right? H of X plus x0 via h of x plus dx0 is equal to f of x plus t alpha, right? For every x that I take into the domain of f, of course. Where, let me write it in color, where alpha, where the constant alpha will be chosen in such a way that H is an element of P. So indeed, we must ensure that, for H to be an element of P, we must ensure that the sublinearity properties are actually fulfilled. That is H of X plus T X zero, right? Which is equal to F of X plus T x0 is less or equal to P of x plus T x0, right, for every. X belonging to the domain of F and for everything in R. So this is actually, because basically, the H that we define here actually fulfills all the properties of the set P except for this last one here. We need to ensure that this holds. So in view, let me write it, right? In view of the property that P of lambda x, right? Because P is sublinear, right? It's equal to lambda P of x for every lambda positive, right? It suffices to check that f of x plus alpha is less or equal than p of x plus x0 and f of x minus alpha is less or equal than p of x minus x0. Let me kind of separate them a bit. Yeah, good. Right. And this should hold for every x in domain of F. So observe that this first property here implies that alpha is actually less or equal than the inf of what, of the P of X plus X0, right, minus F of X with the X belonging to the domain of F. The second property here implies that alpha should be greater or equal than the supremum over the y in domain of f of y minus p of y minus x0. So that is, you must basically find alpha such that now I have to write a bit smaller. So you must find alpha between the supremum and the infimum of these quantities, x in the domain of f, y in the domain of f, and then of course such an alpha exists, right? We write it. Such an alpha exists since f of y plus x is equal to f of y plus f of x, right? By definition, right? Because f is actually in an element of p, so this is the equivalent p of x plus y, right? Which is maybe I don't go. Let me go slowly. This is again p of x plus x0 plus y minus, but p is sublinear, so this is less or equal than p of x plus x0 plus p of y minus x0, right? So this means that the quantity that you have on the less or equal than p of x plus x0 minus f of x, and this holds for every x belonging to the, for every x and y in the domain of f. So such an alpha exists, right? Because I mean this quantity here is, I mean, it's less than this one, so which means that, I mean, this supremum is maybe less than this infimum, so I can always find an alpha between both of them. So since such an alpha exists, right, we conclude that F is in relation with H, right? But this is impossible. Right? Since F is maximal. Different from f, so this is a contradiction. So this actually ends the proof, right? So it was mainly about applying the Zahn lemma, right? I mean, the main idea here is actually to construct the set P, and then everything follow quite easily. So we now describe some application of theorem 1.1 of the Hahn-Banach theorem, the analytic form, right? But now in the case in which E is actually a non-vector space. So let's start with some notation. Yeah. So we denote E star, right, to be the Joule space of E. I mean, this is nothing else than the space of all continuous linear functional on E, right? The Joule norm of E is actually defined Junum on Easter is defined by the norm of F on Easter is actually the supremum of the absolute value of f of x, right? For the x in E. So I should have the norm of x is less or equal than 1. This is again the supremum. Can you even remove the absolute value if you want? So when there is no confusion, when there is no confusion, we will write, instead of writing this, we just write the norm of f, right? And also, instead of writing f of x, we will write this, we will have this notation, the dual pairing, right? Between f and x. So let's have first corollary. Corollary 1.2. This is also known as the Hahn-Banach extension theorem. This is the, if you want, the topological form. So let again G a subset, a linear subspace here, now you have a norm space of the norm space. The norm space E. Right? If G is actually a continuous linear functional on G, right? And G belongs to G star, then there is a continuous linear functional f on E that extends G, and such that the norm of f in E star is nothing less than the norm of G in G star. Then there exists, use this color, there exists f, right? A linear bounded operator on E star that extend G, right? That is F restricted to G equal to G, and such that the norm of F is, the norm of the extension is unchanged. So the proof is just an application of theorem 1.1, right? So we are not going to prove it, right? But let's just give the hint. Use theorem 1.1, right? With P, right? Defined to be the norm of G times the norm of X. It's just an application, right? It's not difficult. You can actually do it as an exercise if you want. So let's have a remark. Number one, first remark. I mean, if D is dense in E, then the extension is unique. By continuity, of course. Second remark. So, I mean, this the first remark basically says that, I mean, the Hahn-Banach theorem, I mean, does not ensure uniqueness. So, to have uniqueness, you need, I mean, the linear subspace G to be dense in E. So, the second remark is. I mean, if E is a Hilbert space, right? If E is a Hilbert space, the extension, I mean, is also kind of constructive. The extension is also. Constructive. How do we see that? Indeed, one can extend first, one can extend first G on G to F hat, right, on the closure. Of D by continuity. I mean, this is always possible. And then use the fact that, let me write it. And then use the fact that, I mean, because E is a Hilbert space, E can be written as and G is a linear subspace, then this is the orthogonal of the closure of G. And now I can put, she put F defined from E to R, which at X associate F of X equal to F hat of x hat, right, with x equals x hat plus x hat orthogonal, right, where x hat is in the closure and x hat is in the orthogonal of the closure. So if E is a Hilbert space, then I mean the extension is constructive. Okay, probably the last remark. In general, I mean there is no constructive extension. So in general, there is no constructive. Extension, and for the simple reason that indeed, I mean, for the Banach space, E, maybe we do not have a decomposition. of the form, say E equals direction if V bar, right? Such that U bar and V bar are close, and U bar intersected with V bar. So in general, there is no constructive extension, because for a Banach space, we do not always have such a decomposition. Let's take an example, right, to see it concretely. Let's take an example. Put E to be L infinity, right, and U bar to be C0. Well, this C0, what is, just to remind you, C0 is the space of sequences, right, in L infinity, such that the limit of xn is 0. There is no closed subspace. Let me write it in capital letter. There is no closed subspace V bar, right, such that L infinity is a direct sum of C0 and V bar. So that means, L infinity is not complemented. Okay, good. Then we have our second corollary. Corollary 1.3. So for every x0, for every element in E, there exists, let me write it in color, so there exists a linear bounded operator on E, right, such that the norm of F0 is equal to the norm of x0, right? The dual bracket of x0 of f0 and x0, which is, f of x0 is equal to the norm of x0 squared. Well, the proof again is, it's very simple. So the proof is, let me write it for you. The proof is just an application of corollary 1.2, right? If D equals the span of x0 and the linear functional is defined to be equal to T times the norm of x0 squared, right? So that the norm of D is equal to the norm of x0. So the proof is just an application of this theorem. Okay. Another remark is that the element F0, actually given in this corollary, is in general not unique. So, remark. The element F0 given corollary 1.3 is in general not unique. However, if E is a Hilbert space, right, or E is actually equals to, I mean, to LP, P strictly, I mean, let me just write it, right? However, let me write it with another color. However, if E is a Hilbert space, or E is equal to, I mean, is an LP space, right? P is strictly greater than 1 and less than infinity, or the dual of E is actually strictly convex. Then F0 is unique. Okay, take another corollary, probably the last for this session. Corollary 1.4. I mean, for every x in E, we have it holds. That norm of x, right, is equal to the supreme norm of the absolute value of f of x, right, where f belongs to e star, such that norm of f is less or equal than 1. And then, I mean, in this case, the supreme norm is always attained, so I can even replace the supreme norm by the max. Okay, the proof is also quite easy, right? Let me write the proof. I mean, the case x equals 0 is really trivial, so you may always assume that x is different from 0. So, first of all, it is clear. I think we all agree on that. It is clear that the supreme norm of the absolute value of f of x, right, over f in E star, such that norm of f is less or equal than 1, is less or equal than the norm of x, right? I mean, this follows from the continuity of f, and the fact that norm of f is actually less or equal than 1. Okay, on the other hand, right? On the other hand, we know from corollary 1.3, let me regulate that. You know from corollary 1.3 that there exists F0, right, in E star, such that the norm of F0 is equal to the norm of X and the Joule bracket, right? F0 comma X is equal to the norm of X squared. Then, well, what you have to put, I mean, you put F1 to be F0 divided by norm of X. Then norm of F1, right, is of just equals 1, and the Joule bracket of F1 comma X is equal to the norm of X. So hence norm of X is equal to the supremum. Okay, and then this finishes the proof, right? I mean, basically we showed that, I mean, the supremum, I mean, it was actually less or equal than the norm of X, and then we were supposed to prove now that norm of X, I mean, is actually less or equal than the supremum. And then for that, we needed to find a function f in E star such that the norm of f is less or equal than 1, and the Joule bracket is equal to norm of x. And that is exactly what we did here with the F1. Good. Now, we start another part of the lecture. We are going to talk about the geometric forms of the Hahn-Banach theorem. 1.2, the geometric forms of the Hahn-Banach theorem. It as usual, so namely separation of convex sets. Okay, in the following, I mean, as I said earlier, I mean, E denotes now a non-vector space. So we start with a definition. Definition. And a fine hyperplane, I mean, is a subset. Let me write it with this color. And a fine hyperplane is a subset H of E, right, of the form H is equal to what? Those are the set of points of E such that F of X is equal to alpha, where F is a linear functional, right? just linear. So, I mean, it doesn't need to be continuous. So, the linear functional that does not vanish identically. It does not vanish identically, and alpha is a constant, right? So we often write h. Right, and say that F equal alpha is the equation of the hyperplane. Okay, let's have this first proposition. Proposition 1.5. So the hyperplane is closed if and only if F is continuous. Is closed if and only if F is continuous. Close if and if F is continuous. Good. Let's have a look at the proof. Okay, so we first start with the easier part, right? I mean, if F is continuous, then it's kind of obvious that H will be closed. If F is continuous, then H can be written as the preimage of what, of the singleton alpha, and it is obviously closed, right? Image of a closed set. So a continuous map. Good. This part was really easy. So now we assume that H is closed. Conversely, let's assume H is close, right? And then you want to show that that F is continuous. So H close means that H complement is open. Is open, and obviously non-empty, right? Because non-empty, since let me write it, since F does not vanish identically. Well, I will give you a short proof of this claim somehow. F does not vanish identically means that F is different from zero, right? So this zero is actually the zero of E star, so, or the zero, of the zero linear functional, if you want. So So f different from 0 means that, I mean, there is this y in E such that f of y is different from 0. So x plus y, you agree with me that x plus y belong to h complement, right? For every x that I take into h. So let, I mean, since, I mean, we prove that that h complement is open and non-empty, let x0 be an element of h complement. We know that it's non-empty, so we can always find an element inside. So that means, saying that x0 is in the complement of h means that x0 do not fulfill the equation of the hyperplane. So this is different from alpha, right? And then without loss of generality, we assume that f of x0 is actually strictly less than alpha. Fix R positive, right? Such that the ball centered at x0 and radius R is contained into H complement. I mean, such an R always exists, right? Because, I mean, H complement is open and x0 is an element of H complement. So I can always find the ball around x0 that is contained into H complement. Now, my first claim is that. Remember, I want to prove that f is continuous. So my first claim is that f of x is strictly less than alpha for every x that I take in the ball centered at x0 and radius r. Good. To prove the claim, I mean, we proceed by contradiction. I really like contradiction. So aiming to a contradiction. So aiming to a contradiction, assume that there is an element in the ball that do not fulfill the required property. Such that f of x1 is strictly greater than alpha, then by convexity of the ball, let me write directly the convexity of the ball, the segment let me write it this way. The set of points xt x1 plus t x0, right? So just t belong to 0, 1. So this is contained in the whole. I mean, this follows by convexity and nothing else. And thus, because it is actually contained in the ball, f of x t, right, is different from alpha for every t, because the ball is contained into h complement. Let me write it here just to remind you, as this ball is contained into h complement. Good. On the other hand, for t equal for this particular t, right, which is equal to f of x1 minus alpha, divided by f of x1 minus f of x0, right? I mean, this is obviously an element of 0, 1, right? I mean, this is strictly positive, if you want. We have, so for this particular t, we have f of x t equals to, let me write it, I mean, slowly. This would be alpha minus f of x0 over f of x1 minus f of x0 times f of x1, right, plus f of x1 minus minus alpha divided by f of x1 minus f of x0. And this is equal to alpha, right? Which is a contradiction, because I mean we proved that, I mean, by convexity of the ball, that f of x t, I mean, was supposed to be different from alpha for all t in 0, 1. But for this particular t, we have that f of x equal to alpha. So this is obviously a contradiction. So f of x is strictly less than alpha for every x in the ball. And this means, I think we are almost done with the proof. So this means, I mean, for half an element x in the ball centered at x0 and radius r, then by translation you can always, so this means f of x0 plus rz, right, strictly less than alpha for every z now in the unit ball. Right? So this means by linearity, right? F of z is strictly less than 1 over r of alpha minus f of x0. Right? So we can even see it as norm of z, but norm of z is actually equal to 1. So this proves the continuity. F is continuous and norm of f is even less or equal than alpha minus f of 1 over r times alpha minus f of x0. And then we are done. Okay. So let's take another definition. So let A and B be two subset of E, right? We say that the hyperplane H, right, separate A and B, right, if f of x, right, is less or equal than alpha for every x in A, and f of x is greater or equal than alpha for every x in B. The separation is strict if, let me write it, separation is strict if there exists any epsilon positive, right? Such that write it same color. F of x is less or equal than alpha minus epsilon for every x in A, and f of x greater or equal than alpha plus epsilon for every x in B. So basically, I mean geometrically, we have something like, maybe try to draw it quickly. So you have something like this, say this is a set A, right? And then you have something like here, then say this is a set B, and then you have somehow the hyperplane here, like this. Good. So basically you have something like this, right? Okay, I think we have all the tools now to state our first theorem, right? The Hahn-Banach first geometric form. Theorem 1.6. Hahn-Banach. First geometric form. Okay, let A be a subset of E, B also a subset of E, B two non. Let A and B be two non-empty convex subset such that A intersected with B is equal to the empty set. Let me highlight the fact that the two sets should be non-empty and convex, and they should be disjoint. Good. Assume that one of them is open. Then there exists a closed hyperplane that separates A and B. Good. So the proof of this theorem actually heavily relies on the following lemma. So I think we will first of all prove the following lemma before proving the theorem. So lemma 1.2. Let's see, be a non-empty open convex set. Let's see, be a non-empty open convex set, and let x0, right, not belonging to C, then they exist. They exist F in E star, right? The linear bounded operator on E, such that F of X is strictly less than F of X zero for every X in C. Sorry. I mean, this is another way of saying that, in particular, the hyperplane separate the singleton x0 and C. Okay, so if I have a non-empty open convex set, right, open and convex set such that x0 is not an element of C, then I can always find a hyperplane that separates x0 and C. So let's have a proof. Let's have a look at the proof. Just to be precise, proof of lemma 1.2. So, first of all, observe that, after translation, we may always assume that zero belongs to C, right? Because, translation actually preserves properties, yeah. So, after translation, you can we may always assume we may always assume that zero is an element of C. So let's introduce, what I introduced at the very beginning of this lecture, the Minkowski functional of C. Let's introduce the Minkowski functional of C. Since x0 is not an element of C, right? We know that x0 is actually different from 0, right? Otherwise, x0 would be an element of C. So, let me write it for you. Otherwise, if x0 equal to 0, we have which is absolute because 0 is an element of C. So now put, because x0 is actually different from 0, then I can define the span of x0 that I denote by g. Right, I say this is the span, so this is right, and then construct this linear functional from G to R which maps Tx0 to G of Tx0 equal T, right? G in R. So by case distinction, this easy, and let me just write it. So by case distinction, it is easy, it is clear, voila, it is clear that g of x, right, is less or equal than the Minkowski functional of C, at the point x. And then we saw that the Minkowski functional for a convex open set is actually sublinear. Well, we can actually prove this, maybe very quickly. Let me just write it in bracket here. I mean, if g is positive, then you have d of t x0 equal to t, right? However, p of t x0 is equal to t p of x0, right? And we know that, I mean, p of x0 is greater or equal than 1, as x0 is not an element of C. So g of t x0, which is equal to t, is less or equal than t times p of x0, which is nothing less than p of t x0. Right? On the other hand, if t is negative, then there is nothing to show, because the Minkowski functional is always positive. Then. So this is, I mean, this would be the kind of the proof. Okay. So we basically constructed a linear functional on G, right? That is actually less or equal than, I mean, a sublinear map. So we can actually directly kind of apply the Hahn-Banach analytic form. So it follows from Turing 1.1. Let me highlight it, right? So you can go back and read it if you want. That there exists a linear functional. A linear functional F on E that extends G. That extends G and satisfies f of x is actually less or equal than p of x for every x in E, right? In particular, because I mean f extends G, so in particular f of x0 is equal to g of x0 is equal to 1, and f is continuous because, let me put it in another color, since we actually saw that, I mean let me just write it, since f of x is actually less or equal than p of x, which is less or equal, we prove it at the very beginning that, I mean, if C is actually convex, open, and 0 belong to C, then P of X, the Minkowski functional of C at the point X is actually less. I can always find a positive constant such that P of X is actually less or equal than M times the norm of X, right, for some M positive. Good, so f is continuous. So with moreover, we prove that we prove that C was, I mean, for C open convex such that 0 belongs to C, so that element of C are element of E, such that the Minkowski functional at the point x is actually strictly less than 1, right? So consequently, right, f of x, right, remember what you saw here, f of x was actually less or equal than p of x for every x in e, so f of x is actually strictly less than 1, right, for every x in c, because f of x is actually strictly less than p of x, which is actually strictly less than 1 for every x in c. So, and this one is actually, let me put it in this one. This one was actually f of x 0, right? So we can conclude that f equal separate. Good, so this ends the proof of lemma 1.2, I think so. And now we can prove the Hahn-Banach first geometric form. Proof. Of theorem 1.6, I think so. Okay. I mean, this is basically an application of the previous lemma. So assume A is open, right? Assume A is open, and put C equals to A minus B, right? So that C is convex. You can easily check it. C is convex, right? C is open. Because C is open because C is basically it can be written as the union over the y in B of A minus Y. Right? And A minus Y, this is actually kind of the translation of an open set, so it's also open, so this is union of open sets are actually open. So 0 actually does not belong to, it's not an element of C, right, as A and B are disjoint, right? So by lemma, so by lemma 1.2, right? Let me highlight it first. By lemma 1.2, there exists. There is some linear bounded functional f, right, and e, such that f of z is strictly less than f of 0, right? Which is nothing less than 0 because f is linear, right? For every z in C. So this means the element of C actually can be written as element of A minus element of B. So this means f of x is strictly less than f of y for every x in A. For every y in B. So fix, can always fix a constant. Alpha, right? Satisfying sup of f of x over the x in A, less or equal than alpha. I mean, such an alpha always exists, right? So the y in B similarly this separate A and B. By the way, if you have any question, please you can put it or write it in the comment section and I'd be happy to answer you, right? And you can always kind of send me an email if you feel I can be of any help on any of your problems or things that you fail to understand. So this basically ends the proof, right? And then we have let's take the Hahn-Banach second geometric form. This is theorem 1.7. Hahn-Banach second geometric form. So let A and B, right? Let A be two non-empty, non-empty convex. Subset, right? Such that disjoint. Assume that A is closed and B is compact. Highlight the most important point. In this case, you have A closed, B compact, right? In addition to A and B being convex and disjoint, right? Then there exists a closed hyperplane that strictly separates A and B. Okay, let's prove this. Well, put C to be A minus B, right? So that C is convex. Close, right? As A is close. And zero does not belong to C, right? So because C is actually close, zero is not an element of C means that I can find a ball or radius or I can find a ball of radius R such that around zero, such that that ball do not intersect C. So here you have the ball and see actually this one, the ball is actually open, right, and convex. So we can apply the Hahn-Banach first geometric form. So by equivalent 1.6. There is a closed happy plane. That separates. The ball and C. Right, so that means I there is this F linear bounded operator on E, right, that do not vanish identically. Such that f of x minus y is less or equal than f of c r z, right? For every x in A, for every y in B, and for every z in the unit ball. Probably not visible. For every z in the unit ball. Good. So by symmetry it follows that by symmetry, right? Because if z is actually in the unit ball, minus z is also in the unit ball, so by symmetry it follows that f of x minus y is actually less or equal than minus r norm of f, right? For every x in A and for every y in B. So letting epsilon being equal to 1 over 2 r times norm of f, right, which is strictly positive, right, we get f of x plus epsilon is less or equal than f of y minus epsilon for every x in A and for every y in B. So if you choose alpha again, it's actually the same trick. Choosing alpha such that the supremum of f of x over the x in A plus epsilon less or equal than alpha less or equal than inf f of y over the y in B minus epsilon, we see that this strictly separate A and B. Let's end the proof. Good. So let's have some remark, right, about the two Hahn-Banach geometric form that we stated. Remark: assume that A subset of E and B subset of E, right, are two non-empty convex set. such that A intersected with B is equal to the empty set, right? So if you have two non-empty convex sets that are disjoint, if you have, let me write it. If you have no further assumption, it is in general, right? So if you don't know whether A is open or closed or B is compact, it is in general, let me write it in capital letter, impossible. It is in general impossible to separate A and B by a closed hyperplane. However, if you have some special cases, if E is finite dimensional, one can always separate any two non-empty convex set A and B such that so no further assumption is actually required. I mean, if you're actually in finite dimensional case. So put it in bracket. So no further assumption. Is required. Good. So we have this the following corollary. Corollary 1.8. Okay, so let F be a linear subspace. And this is not straight. Let F be a linear subspace such that the closure of F is actually different from E. That means F is not dense in E. Then there exists linear bounded operator on E, right? That do not vanish identically, such that f of x is equal to 0 for every x in F. Proof. Okay. So let x0 belong to write it, let x0 belong to E, right? Such that x0 does not belong to F bar. I mean, F is not dense in E, so such an x0 always exists, right? Now, using theorem 1.7, using theorem 1.7, if A equals to the closure of F, right, which is obviously closed, and B equal to the singleton X0, right, which is actually compact, we find the closed hyperplane that's strictly separate. F, I mean the closure, I mean A and B, right? The closure of F and X0. So this we have f of x is actually strictly less than alpha, which is strictly less than f x0, right? This is for every x in the closure, right? I mean, if this inequality holds for every x in the closure, I mean, it holds for every x in F, right? So it follows that this equals to 0 for every x in F. I mean, since why is that? Because I mean, since lambda f of x is strictly less than alpha for every lambda in R, and then this proof the claim, this and the proof of the theorem. So the last remark for this section, we'll use the color. Okay. So what you need to note is that, I mean, the above corollary is, I mean, the above corollary 1.8, right, is very, very used, right, often used in proving this use. Very often in proving that a linear subspace F, I mean, is dense. In fact, it suffices to show kind of the contraposition of what we show above. It suffices to show that every linear bounded operator on E, right, such that F restricted to F is equal to 0 implies that, I mean, F is equal to the 0 is identically, vanishes identically. Good. Okay, I think we will end this lecture with by talking about the bidual and probably some orthogonality relation. So 1.3, the bidual. Right. Doesn't look nice. Bidual orthogonality relation. Good. Let E be a norm vector space, right? Let E be a norm vector space, right? So this is NVS, is short for norm vector space, right? So the bidual E star star, E double star, is nothing else than the dual of E star, the dual of the dual, with norm. We say that the norm of zeta, E star star is equal to the supremum. This is zeta f, the f in E star, right? So the norm of f is less or equal than 1. So there is a canonical injection, basically. There is a canonical injection often called iota or j if you want, right, from E to E star star, right, which at x associate g of x, which is again kind of defined from E star to R via f equals to what, dx comma f, right? Remember, this dual plane is actually let me probably shift it slightly so that you can see. Good. So this is the dual plane between the bidual and the dual. So this means that this is nothing else than this is defined as being the dual pairing of f and x. So it is it is easy to check that J is linear and that J is an isometry. That is, you see that it's an isometry means that the norm of dx, right, it's nothing else than the norm of x in E. Well, to see that it is not actually difficult, let me write it quickly. Indeed, the norm of, by definition, right, the norm of dx in Is that is the supremum of gx comma f, right? Or the f in E star push that norm of f is less or equal than 1, and this is nothing less than the supremum of absolute value of f of x such that f belong to E star and norm of f is less or equal than 1, right? And well, by definition, by corollary 1.4, I think, so this is norm of x, and this is, I mean, this equality follows from by corollary 1.4. So if J is surjective, then one says that E is reflexive, right? So if J is surjective, then one says that the space E is reflexive. And therefore we can identify the Bidual with the space E. And E star star is identified with E. Okay. Let's take some notation again. Notation. If M is a subset of E, right? The linear subspace. Subspace, right? We set M orthogonal, right, to be the set of element of E star such that the dual pairing of f and x is equal to 0 for every x in M. Right. If N is a subset of the dual, right? The linear subspace. We define the orthogonal of N as being the set of X in E, right? Such that f of x is equal to 0 for every f in n. Well, you put it right. I mean, it is clear that m orthogonal and n orthogonal are close. I mean, that you can check, and if you have any problem, just put all your concern in the comment section, and then I'll be happy to enlighten you or give you some solutions. Good. And then take proposition 1.9. Position 1.9. Okay, let M bilinear subspace of E. Then this color, the orthogonal of M is nothing else than the closure of M. Then let N the linear subspace of the dual. Then we had to have the inclusion. This is contained to the orthogonal of the orthogonal. Okay, proof. So start with the first inclusion, right? So maybe I recall directly because at times it may be confusing. I mean, the orthogonal of the orthogonal is nothing less than the set of X in E, right? So should that F of X equal to 0 for every F belong to M orthogonal, right? So this means that for every X that I take into M, right? And for every f that I take into M orthogonal, f of x is equal to 0. So it is clear that M is contained into M orthogonal. And since this is closed, we have M orthogonal to contain into, I mean, M, the closure of M is contained to the orthogonal of the orthogonal of M. So, I mean, if you follow the same procedure, you can show that N, the closure of N is contained into the orthogonal of the orthogonal of N. So we are not going to show that anymore. Okay, so the other things, or the other inclusion, right? So conversely, let's show that M orthogonal is contained into the closure of M. Well, M into a contradiction, suppose by contradiction that, I mean, there exists an x0, I mean, to the orthogonal of the orthogonal of M, such that x0 does not belong to the closure. Then by theorem 1.1, I mean the Hahn-Banach second geometric form, then by theorem 1.7, I think, yeah. Let me highlight it again so you can go back and read it. There is the closed hyperplane. They strictly separate. This and M auto and the closure of M. So that means I can find a linear bounded operator on E and there is alpha in R, right? Such that f of x, wanted to write it in dual pairing form. This is strictly less than alpha, which is strictly less than this, and this holds for every x in M. I mean, it holds for every x in the closure, but also for every x in M. Now, since M is a linear subspace, follows that f of x is equal to 0 for every x in M, and also f of x 0 is strictly greater than 0, right? So therefore F is actually into an element of the orthogonal of M, right? And consequently, F of x 0 should be equal to 0, which is a contradiction. So, I think we are basically done, right, with the proof. It is a contradiction, so this end the proof, right? Contradiction because, let me explain it, we have this relation here, f of x 0, strictly greater than 0, I mean, it follows from here. I mean, we saw that because M was actually a linear subspace, we saw that, that f of x was equal to 0 for every x in M, right? So that means this is greater than 0. F of x 0 is strictly greater than 0. But this equal to 0 for every x in M actually implies that F is actually into the complement, the orthogonal of M, right? But x 0 is actually an element of what of, let's see again, x 0 is an element of the orthogonal of the orthogonal of M. So that means this should be 0, and which is a contradiction, contradict this sort. And then we are done. So we have the double inclusion, and so I write something. It is also clear that N is a subset of N orthogonal, right? And this closure is contained to N orthogonal. So this will also end the proof of the second statement. So I think we will stop here for today, right? We have done a lot. So thank you very much for all of you actually listening to this, and we see again each other, in the next video.